Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bethlehem United Methodist Church on this wonderful fall day with its liquid sunshine. Makes everything grow. Please sign the attendance folder, which you'll find on the end of the pew, and then pass it to the person next to you. When it gets to the end, pass it back the other way. Note if there are any visitors in the pew, and at the time when we pass the peace, greet them and welcome them to our church as well. As a reminder, we have a nursery for children up to age 3. Children ages 4 through first grade are invited to attend Kids Corner, which is our children's church following the children's time. Second graders and above are encouraged to use the big kid binders and remain in the worship service. Please refer to your bulletin for the announcements, but I'd like to bring a few of them to your attention at this time. A new spiritual formation group is forming, and an introductory meeting is scheduled for Thursday, November the 5th at 7 p.m. A sign-up sheet is available on the church bulletin board, or you may contact the church office to register. The deadline for Operation Christmas Child Shoeboxes is now November the 15th. Our goal is 211 shoeboxes for the 211th anniversary of the church. Please help us fill this goal for this year. A new upper room discussion group will be meeting on Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. at Stacy's Sweet Shop in downtown Moneta, beginning on Saturday, November the 7th. And now let us stand for the call to worship found on page 711 of your hymnal. We will be singing all verses.
Thank you. join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. From the depths of our being, a song of thanks arises, and we pour out our praise for all of God's gifts. Bread to empower our bodies, beauty to quicken our pulse, hope to enlarge our vision, love to link our lives with each other and all the saints, laughter to soften our wounds, passion to shape our maybes, community to face our fears, and for this awesome All Saints Day to become filled with joy and touched by grace. Let us pray together. O God of both the living and the dead, we praise your holy name for all your servants who have faithfully lived and died. We thank you for the sacred ties that bind us to those unseen who encompass us as a cloud of witnesses. We pray that, encouraged by their example and strengthened by their fellowship, we may be diligent followers and that nothing will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I invite you to pass the peace. Please greet your neighbors, welcome them. The peace of the Lord be with you. Thank you. Please be seated. And Reverend Ray comes to lead us in the children's time. So I'd like to invite all of the children to come up for our children's time.
You did? Well, today is a special day in the life of the church. Today is a day called All Saints Day. And this is a day where we celebrate the communion of saints. So I'm going to teach you a little story about one saint, and then I'm going to tell you about another one. Do you see this man? His name is Saint Francis. And Tyler, can you see what Saint Francis is holding in his hand? It's a bird. He's holding a bird in his hand. So Saint Francis is a saint that is often depicted with creatures. Sometimes he holds a bunny in his hand, and sometimes he holds a bird in his hand. Sometimes he's got a little squirrel around his feet. And the reason we remember Saint Francis and animals is because there's lots of stories that tell us that he used to preach to animals. There's this one story where they said he lived way, way back when, and he was talking to the birds, and he said, "Birds, you know, praise God and sing, spread out your wings and praise God." And you know what the birds did? They all spread their wings out like this. Can you pretend you are a bird and spread your wing out like this? And they stretched their necks up like this. And then Saint Francis walked among them, and they didn't fly away or anything, and they just sang and sang and sang. So Saint Francis is kind of a formal idea of a saint. Now then this, what is this? It's a church. This was my great-grandmother's church, and it plays a song. It plays the song Amazing Grace, and her name was Georgia Smith, and she taught me a lot about God. How many of you have grandmas and grandpas? Do they teach you about God? So my Gigi taught me a lot about who God is and how much God loves me. It is beautiful, thank you. And I carry this, and this stays in my office, and I have it, and it reminds me of her, and she is also a saint. Did you know? Look around this room. Look at all these people. We all get to be saints. Isn't that neat? Because we all teach each other about what it means to be God. Some of us, like Miss Rojane, teaches us about what it means to be God in Sunday school. She's a great teacher. Robin and Robbie teach us about God through music and the choir. Pastor Lord teaches us about God on Sunday. There's lots of ways we can learn about God. Our moms and dads teach us about God's love. So today we celebrate all the saints around us. My Gigi's not with us anymore, so we celebrate her and her life. And Saint Francis isn't with us anymore, but we celebrate him and what he teaches us about creation and how to love God's animals. So today, let's say a prayer for all our saints and give thanks. Can we put our hands together? Bow your head and close your eyes. God, we give you thanks for today. We give you thanks for the communion of saints, those who are with us now and those who have passed on, who teach us about you and what it means to love and be a better Christian. We give you thanks and ask that you bring us back here safely next week. Amen.
Okay, thank you very much, Reverend Heather. Thank you, boys and girls. It's a joy to have all of you here on this All Saints Sunday as we celebrate those who have gone before us and celebrate this time together. It's good to have Verna Fittero and Mike with us. Verna was diagnosed with lung cancer back in the summer, wasn't it? And she had surgery and was then in rehab, but did not have to have radiation or chemo, and they're saying now you're cancer-free. So it's good to have Verna back with us. Right. And all of you, thanks for being here on this Sunday. As we move towards our prayer time, Heather will come to gather prayer requests and lead us in our call to prayer and the morning prayer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Do you all have any prayer requests this morning that you would like to share? Yes.
Well, I'd like prayers for my sister-in-law, Linda, who lost her mother yesterday.
Linda, who lost her mother yesterday. Yes.
Martha's son today
Martha is home today with baby Eden, who's not feeling well, so we'll pray for Eden.
Heather?
Yes.
Bob Simmons had a stroke last Monday, but they found out that he had a blocked carotid artery. He was operated, the stroke happened Monday. On Wednesday, he was operated on. The artery was cleared out. He made a complete recovery. He's home now. He's expected to make a complete recovery from that stroke. So his wife, Judy, who most of us know here, is asking for praise.
We will absolutely praise that Bob Simmons, as he had a stroke earlier this week, but is now back at home and recovering. So we give praise to God for that.
We can have Bill Lynn with us today.
Bill Lynn being here with us today, that's a praise. Yes, absolutely.
Juana Marco's sister Sherry died.
And if you can't hear David, he said Juana Marco's sister died this week. So prayers for her and her family as well. Yes. Okay, Kim Jordan, whose mom's in hospice, and they're preparing to say goodbye to her mother. Are there any other prayer requests this morning? Yes. And her name is Wynn Lane, who started medication for her cancer this week. Thank you. Are there any other prayer requests? Yes.
Heather, for the people who died in that plane crash and their families.
The people who died in the plane crash and their families. Absolutely. Are there any other prayer requests? If not, oh yes. Persecuted Christians. Yes. Are there any other prayer requests? If not, let's go to our choral call to prayer, which is found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Loving God, we come before you eager to experience your love and presence as we worship you together. We pray that in this time of worship, we may be called out of ourselves and into you. And we pray we might remember and be challenged by the call you have on each of our lives to be the body of Christ in the world. We recognize in this time the ways in which we have failed to live lives according to your will, the way we have failed to love our neighbors as ourselves, and the way we have failed to even love just us, the ways in which we have chosen not to respond to the difficult things, the ways in which we have failed to thank you for all that you have given us. In this place and in this time, we ask you for forgiveness, loving and gracious God. We are thankful that you are a loving God, whose forgiveness draws us into closer relationship with you. We lift up to you at this time the many people, places, and issues that bring us joy and also leave us burdened and worried. God, we take the time now to lift to you our many joys and concerns. We lift up our brothers and sisters who are mourning, grieving, or feeling alone. We pray for Wanda Merkel and her family on the passing of her sister. We pray for Linda, who lost her mother this week. And we pray for Kim Jordan and her family as they prepare to lose their mother. We lift up our brothers and sisters recovering from surgery, anticipating surgery, battling an illness, searching for a diagnosis. We pray specifically for baby Eden and her health. We pray for Wynn Lane and the beginning of her medication. We pray for Melissa Hicks' mother in the hospital. We give you thanks for Bob Simmons as he continues to recover, and we ask that you be with all of them. We lift up concerns for the people who died in the plane crash and their families. Be with them, Lord. And we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted, especially for those who are persecuted in the Middle East. We lift up to you the concerns of this world, God, for those that we are aware of, and for the many things of which we are not aware. We pray for those in our country who continue to recover from flooding and natural disasters. We pray for our leaders, especially our president and Congress, for our military and their families. We pray for Bishop Cho, District Superintendent Larry Davies, and the United Methodist Church, as well as other Smith Mountain Lake area churches. Today, we pray especially for the communion of saints, those who we love who have gone before us to be with you. We lift their names silently in our hearts to you now. God, we give you thanks for the many people you place in our lives who serve as a reminder of the way in which we are called to live. May we all remember that we are one in Christ, and death cannot separate us from your love. Alleluia. And all God's people say, Amen.
Thank you, Heather. And Heather included in her prayers for the military. Next Sunday is November 8th. It's the closest Sunday to Veterans Day. And we would like to honor our veterans, and particularly the two of our congregation that are veterans of World War II. And we will, up in the conference room, we have a wall of remembrance, and there's a plaque that lists all members of Bethlehem who served in World War II. And the two remaining are Glenn Hicks and Calvin Woodford. So next Sunday, we would like to bring that plaque into the worship service and to honor these two men. So I hope you can be here. So put the pressure on. And then for all of our veterans, we also want to honor you and say thank you for your service to our country. So that'll be next Sunday. Let us now worship as we present to God our tithes and our offerings. praise you and thank you, God, for all of life and for these gifts that we return to you. Multiply them and use them for the glory of your kingdom and the work of your church on earth. We pray in your name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated.
This morning's lesson comes from John chapter 11, verses 32 through 44. You can find it printed on the back of your bulletin or in the Pew Bible. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jew says, "See how he loved him?" Some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take the stone away." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said unto them, "Unbind him and let him go." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Through eternity.
Pray with me. We are grateful for your promises, Lord. And today particularly, we thank you for the promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, and for all those who have died and are with you in glory. And now I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The lectionary readings for today are for All Saints Day, and I do encourage you to read each of the passages, one in Isaiah, one in Revelation, and John, and a theme throughout them all is that we have this promise of eternal life through Christ our Lord, that death has been conquered, and that we have life in Him. And our passage from the Gospel in John is one that is very familiar to you. I probably reference this or preach from this or include it in more sermons than any other passage. If there's a memorial service or a funeral, you will hear parts of this passage read. And if you are not familiar with the whole of the story, it's about some friends of Jesus, Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus, and they're good friends. Jesus loves them as he would love a brother and sisters. And whenever Jesus comes up to Jerusalem, he stays with them at their home in Bethany. Bethany's just a few miles from Jerusalem. And so he knows them well. They know him well. And Lazarus gets sick. He's ill, and it's very serious. And so they send word to Jesus, the sisters do, that the one whom you love is ill. And knowing that Jesus, just hearing that, will come and heal their brother Lazarus, because he loves Lazarus, he loves them, he cares for them, and they know that Jesus can do that, but he doesn't. He doesn't come. And when he finally comes to Bethany, Lazarus has been dead and in the grave 4 days. And Martha comes out to meet him first when she hears that he's close by, and you can hear in her voice her disappointment, her disillusionment, her confusion, her grief, her sadness, even her anger. Lord, if you had only been here, our brother would not have died. And this is where Jesus speaks those words that you will hear in every memorial service or funeral, where he says to Martha, "Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." And he says, "Martha, do you believe this?" And it's a legitimate question, because there were many Jews who did not believe in the afterlife. A group known as the Sadducees didn't believe in the afterlife. Martha says, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Martha returns to the home where her sister Mary is, and she says, "The teacher is here and he's calling for you." And Mary comes out to meet with Jesus. And this is where our passage begins today. Mary came where Jesus was and saw him and knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you have been here, my brother would not have died." It's the same words that Martha spoke. This is, next part has been a part that's always sort of puzzled me. And it's the two-word verse is included here, of Jesus wept. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. I've always wondered why, because Jesus knew what he was about to do. He knew that he was going to turn their sorrow into joy, and in just a little bit, he would be giving back Lazarus to his sisters because he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead, a sign of what was to come, that Jesus conquers death completely. So why was he weeping? A couple of clues. One is this line that says, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. And you see it again when he's down, they take him to the tomb. Again, greatly disturbed, he came to the tomb. It was a cave and a stone was lying against it. Notice this scene. This scene is very reminiscent or a sign of what will come in terms of the tomb where Jesus is laid. It's a cave. There's a stone rolled away, rolled in front of it. This act of raising Lazarus from the dead will lead to Jesus' own death. Not long after this, Jesus will be arrested. He will be tried, a mockery of a trial. He will be crucified and placed in a tomb like this. And when Jesus died, he took upon himself everything wrong about us. All of our failures, all of our disobedience, all of our rebellion against God, all of our greed, all of our self-centeredness, all of the sin in our life, he took that upon himself, which is mystery, and died for that. When his body was given, his blood was shed for us, it was so that we could have life. So my sense is that Jesus is anticipating, looking ahead to the time where he will die. And so in the midst of their grieving, in the midst of the death of Lazarus, thinking about his own death, he weeps. And the term for weeping isn't just, you know, a tear in the eye. It is sobbing. He is disturbed and moved. And he's weeping. Jesus understands death. This is what is so remarkable about God, is that God became one of us in human form and then died. A God who dies. I mean, that's pretty incredible, isn't it? That God in Christ would experience death. So he understands. He knows when we grieve. He grieves with us. He too has experienced death. We're going to the polls on Tuesday to vote. And I just thought, well, we can just sort of practice here, and I want to ask you to vote. And this is the question. It's when Jesus began to weep, the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" And you remember last week, he opened the eyes of Bartimaeus. And so the question is, could Jesus keep Lazarus from dying? Now, if you think the answer to that is yes, raise your hand. Could Jesus keep Lazarus from dying? Okay, we're going to vote here, so that's yes. If you think the answer is no, that Jesus cannot keep Lazarus from dying. So, okay, you got two in the choir. I need to preach to the choir, okay, and to the ushers. Well, I'm going to vote with the second group. And you think, well, what do you mean, vote with the second group? Well, we can read the passage. Jesus raises him from the dead. Why are you saying he can't keep him from dying? Well, is Lazarus still with us? Is he still walking around? No. Lazarus eventually died. Some traditions say 30 years later, and then if you read the scripture, the religious leaders who wanted to do with Jesus also planned to kill Lazarus as well. So it could have been that he died not long after Jesus or around that same time. So Jesus knows about death. and Lazarus went on to die, just like we all do. It's a part of our human existence, our who we are as people. And you can see it even in creation. When you go outside today, you might see a beautiful maple tree in all its glory and fall colors with translucent yellows and golds and reds. But soon, after a rain and the wind, those leaves are all going to be off. And fall is going to turn into winter with the coldness and the deadness. It's like creation itself is telling us that this is a part of life. And we live, we're born, we grow, we age, we die. It's a part of who we are. And yet there's good news. The good news, and Jesus is about to show that good news. This is a sign of what Jesus can do. He has power over death. And he goes to the tomb. And I love this scene where he calls out into that tomb. First of all, there's a couple things I'd like to just mention in this passage that I think speak to us. And it has to do what Jesus doesn't do. He doesn't just wave and the stone is rolled away. Remember, there's this huge stone in front of the tomb, just like Jesus' tomb. And in Jesus' tomb, the women came and an angel descended and rolled the stone away. So Jesus doesn't do that. He doesn't go over and roll it away himself. What does he do? He tells them, roll away the stone. And they roll away the stone. It probably took a number of them to roll it away. And I think the message to that is that we can be used of God to roll stones away in people's lives. What are the barriers that people face to keep them from living life to its fullness? What are the barriers in this world? Racism, ageism, people with disabilities, people living in poverty. These are barriers to full life often. You know, the largest segment of our society in poverty today are women. Women that work 3 jobs and they can't make ends meet. Women with children, these are people living in poverty today. And we can roll stones away. Jesus uses us as his hands and feet to bring people to life, spiritual life. He goes to the tomb and he calls out, Lazarus, come forth. And I remember this scene from a movie, how I was intent on watching that. And there in the tomb, when Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth, this man came out wrapped in it. And I was a kid, and I remember it scared me a little bit because he looked like a mummy. You know, he was all wrapped up, but he was moving. And again, Jesus doesn't go over to him and start unwrapping him. Jesus doesn't lay hands on him and those grave clothes fall off, those wrappings. What does he say? He says to the others, unwrap him, loosen him. What does our scripture say? Unbind him and let him go. Again, what is it that has people bound today? Addictions have people bound. And again, not just the normal ones that we think of, drugs, alcohol, pornography, gambling, but other addictions too, like watching too much television, eating too much, shopping too much, spending too much. We're coming on that season of spending, and so many people get into trouble. They get into credit card debt. They go overboard because there's something that they're trying to fill. There's some space there that only God can fill, but they're trying to do it themselves. We can help people in that. God uses us to help unbind people. What has people bound? It might be someone in your own neighborhood. You say, well, wait a minute. I've got people in my neighborhood that live in million-dollar homes. Nevertheless, the people that live in those homes might be lonely. Their life might be a mess. They might be grieving. They might be materially wealthy but spiritually poor. All around us, there are people that need to be unbound, and God can use us in that. Just like people in the past have helped us, shown kindness to us, these saints that Heather talked about, people that you can think of right now. And in our communion service in a moment, they're going to come to a place where I'm going to name the names of those, our brothers and sisters, members of our church who have passed away in this past year since last All Saints Day. And then following that, I'm going to give opportunity for you to name names out loud. Saints, people who have cared for you, who have loved you, people like your grandmother, people like a spouse, a friend who helped you in your faith, who cared for you. I'm thinking of my grandmother who prayed for me every day. I'm thinking of my dad who was always saying to me, you know, I love you, I'm proud of you, and he encouraged me. I'm thinking of Virgil Gill, that man when I was a teenager who became a mentor to me, who supported me, who encouraged me, who prayed for me. And many of us can think of people who are now with the Lord, who made your life better. We're going to have an opportunity to thank God for them. So I invite you to turn in your hymnal, if you would, to page 12 for our service of Holy Communion. And for the great Thanksgiving, I'm going to be using one out of the Book of Worship that is for All Saints Day that includes what I just mentioned. So the words that are for you are in the bold print. And we begin with the invitation on page 12 that says, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to confess or pray in silence. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. We'll continue with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and the martyrs, God of our mothers and our fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those whom we name before you, these members of Bethlehem United Methodist Church who have died since last year. Pauline King, November 23rd, 2014. Christine Williamson, April 5th. Elizabeth Wilson, April 6th. Rosemarie Farrar, May 15th. Paula Alexander, September 16th. I invite you now to name those who have died that you would like to remember today. Out loud. Let us observe a time of silence in remembrance of these we have named. Thank you, God, for them. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us, Lord, to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to sing the Lord's Prayer. A reminder, as United Methodists, we observe open communion. All are invited to come to Christ's table. You may be a member of another church or not have a church home. You're invited to come, all ages, all people. If you cannot come forward, we'd be glad to bring the elements to you where you are. Just indicate that to the usher, and we will do that for you. And we will receive by intinction. I'll break off the bread and serve you. You dip it into the cup and receive the two together. And if you prefer to drink from the little cups, we have a station there. If anyone would like to find a place to pray at the altar rail before you return to your pew, you're welcome to do that. The choir will come first, and then the ushers will lead you in coming. Again, it's the Lord's table. He invites you to come. Won't you come? Sing with all the saints of glory. It's number 702 in your hymnal. Let's stand as we sing it together. 702. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Remember, next Sunday we will be honoring our veterans. We'll also be receiving new members into the church, so if there are any of you that would like to officially join the Fellowship of Bethlehem by becoming members, please see me today or call the church office tomorrow. I'd love to include you with those that are joining next week. Will you see the benediction which says, "May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." Amen.